Hi everyone, I'm Caitlin Augustine. I'm the Vice President of Product and Programs at DataKind. We're a global nonprofit organization focused on using data and technology in the service of humanity. And I'm joined by my colleague Talid, who leads our humanitarian efforts and partnerships. And we're going to talk to you about this enormous need in the humanitarian space for timely and high quality data. And to put that in context for you, right now, there are 300 million people in the world in need of humanitarian assistance. There are 40 coordinated global appeals, and the gap in funding is $46 billion. So it is clear that we have to innovate to figure out solutions that can get us to having these timely responses, these efficient uses of resources. And from DataKind's side, we've seen examples of when this has gone incredibly well. This is an example from UN OCHA and their response in Afghanistan for natural disasters. This is a interactive dashboard that is put up and maintained by the UN, and it has data from multiple resources. It has it from the local government, it has it from NGOs, it has it from the UN teams, and it allows the responders to identify where a disaster has occurred and send the right teams with the right interventions in place in a very rapid fashion. But this is unfortunately the exception. It's not the rule. And we know that having high quality data can help us save lives. So DataKind went through a number of interviews with humanitarian organizations, over 24 of them, to say, what are your pain points in actually accessing and using this data if you know it will help you in your response? And we heard a number of pain points and identified places where generative AI could be a meaningful part of that solution while still keeping a human in the loop to help solve those problems. And the problem I'm going to dig into here is metadata prediction. So, why metadata prediction? Well, humanitarians love spreadsheets. Their preferred data sets, it's how they share data. The Humanitarian Data Exchange, which is one of the major repositories of humanitarian data, in 2023 had over 150,000 tabular data sets. And even though those data sets contain information that can save lives, they don't interoperate. And this is despite the fact that 20 years ago, HEXL, a metadata standard, was community created and approved for use. It is a tool that helps you, like this table here says, put the label and the description of the data on each of your columns of your data sets, and it's super easy to use. The example running there is how you would put a line in your spreadsheet. But HEXL hasn't really achieved adoption. It hasn't had its impact. It's time consuming to hand label data. It's error prone. What that ultimately means is that about half of humanitarian data does not have metadata on it at all. And of the half that does have metadata tagging, about half of it is wrong. It's data that isn't standard. It's not in the common corpus. So that data is not fit for purpose. We believe that generative AI could help us in this labeling, this tags and attributes in this data. There was previous work about 5 years ago that showed this as a proof of concept, but had a lot of friction in implementation. And we saw with using GPT that we could actually do this tagging for a more expansive body of knowledge and get it to implementation with far less friction. We started this work in 2023, and we've now expanded it in 2024, completing the last round in August, testing three different models and prompting approaches. So, how did we actually come to this question? Well, if only about 25% of datasets have accurate metadata, we heard from our stakeholders that they almost didn't care. They were like, make it more right than wrong, and we will be happy. We went to the literature, and we saw that in different contexts, but for a similar challenge, 70% accuracy yielded meaningful results in those spaces. So we set an accuracy target of 70%. This is something that we are asking humanitarians, nonprofit organizations, to use. They don't have a budget line for it, so we wanted to ensure that the weekly cost was around $5, and that would allow them to process around 100 tables, which is sort of the load of generation on a weekly basis. And this was going into an existing workflow. We wanted it to be as fast as possible. Our previous work suggested about 1 second processing time per table made sense, and we wanted the total time to take about an hour from our prep to our processing. because we are still having humans be a part of this. They're just now moving from that manual correction of all that metadata and that trying to piece together information to actually just checking the tagging that has happened. And with those goals in mind, we started off on our work. So first, receive the data, right? So we pulled the data from the Humanitarian Data Exchange, and we did a lot of data prep. And I just want to highlight two pieces of this data prep for you because they were helpful learnings for our team as we went through using LLMs. So the first was data enrichment. So if you're a human doing your metadata tagging, you have to read a number of rows to get the context for what you're actually going to label it, right? Your system has to do that too. So we used GPT 3.5 Turbo to create table summaries, and we enriched our data set in that way. The second was creating our test and train set. So standard machine learning flows, right? We will do a random assignment between train and test to produce those data sets. But in this case, we would have had the same organization's data in both train and test because the same organizations are doing all this metadata tagging, they do it all in the same way. Having that random split could have actually led us to sort of artificially positive results. So we created our train and test sets based on organizations. So an organization's metadata could only occur in one or the other of those sets. And then ultimately we created our test files and move forward into actually testing that fine-tuned GPT 4.0 mini model. And the first thing to say is it worked really well for the most common metadata, over 95% accuracy for locations and dates. And since this is the thing that is most crucial to get right, we were thrilled at these results. And it worked well for predicting just the hexal tags, those labels, things like population, like location, like date. But it only worked okay for predicting the tags and the attributes, those descriptors. And when we dug into it, it was kind of interesting to figure out, why did this not work so well? Why were we only getting around 60% accuracy? And the first thing was, we actually found situations where the model and the human were both right. There are synonyms in the hexal standard, so something like location can also be called admin. So human was labeling it one thing, model was labeling the other. They're both correct. What was more interesting was we found situations where the model was right or more right than a human. So the model would actually add more descriptors than the human did. So human might have said this is a population. The model might have said this is a population of women 15 years or younger, giving us more valuable information. And then finally, we had situations where the human labeled data was wrong. Even though it was the correct standard, it was still describing the wrong things, and the model was actually correct. And that actually made us think, maybe this fine-tuning wasn't the best approach, and given the economies of scale with these prompts, could we avoid fine-tuning altogether, instead directly prompt for these hexal tags and attributes? And the answer is sort of, right? You know, all of us have been doing these zero-shot prompts. Out of the box, our answer looked right. You know, we got this answer that seemed like it made sense, but it actually doesn't follow hexal standard at all. The answer looks a lot like what those human-labeled tags were, of the let me figure out what I think the right answers are. So we needed to add instructions into our prompting. We needed to change that to include only the hexal data standard, and we needed to put some rules in place for the order of information that would come out, that we needed the tag, then we needed the attribute. And once we did that, it was great. So our stakeholders were thrilled because we had multiple approaches that hit our accuracy targets in our time constraints and in our cost target. And all of this allowed us to unlock thousands of more variables for humanitarian use. And we're only getting better, right? Today's exciting announcements around distilling, around ongoing improvements, that's what we're taking now into phase two. Because ultimately, metadata prediction is one part of our overall humanitarian data project system. It's just this one box here in gold. There are many other pieces that feed into a tool that we are using and we are making accessible to humanitarians to give them that rapid access to that timely, high-quality data. What you now actually see behind me is our humanitarian AI assistant that is now pulling all of that harmonized, interoperable data together to allow a humanitarian to interact with a chat to get ground truth verified information out to allow them to do a rapid response. This has all been co-created with humanitarians. This is a whistle-stop tour. I know I'm at my time. Please follow us, connect with us. We look forward to talking to you, with you in the future. So.